A big meeting and big teaching in Acts chapter 15. I'm going to summarize this entire stack of books for you today. Let's talk about that. Hey, kids of faith, it's Pastor Chad. We're doing something new this time. We're looking at the sermon in the book of Acts, and we're looking at today what we want to learn about concerning this giant stack of books. And yeah, I'm going to tell you what's inside of all these books today, but it's not going to be super long. So every Sunday, myself or Pastor Adams teaches you something about what we believe, and it's right here in the church bulletin under affirmation of faith. Affirmation of faith. What in the world is that, Pastor Chad? Well, every single Sunday, we all together nod our heads and we say, I believe that about Jesus, and that I believe about God's word. And so we learn in the book of Acts chapter 15 that when there's a big meeting, out of that big meeting comes big teaching. And that's what we're going to learn about today. In Acts chapter 15 verses 1 to 2, it says, but some men came down from Judea and were teaching the brothers. And what were they teaching? Something good or something bad? Well, they were saying, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. And after Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and debate with them, Paul and Barnabas and some of the others were appointed to go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and the elders about this question. What was the question? Who can be saved? Well, where do we go for the answer? Well, we know the answer is in God's word, but there had to be a big meeting. And out of that big meeting came a very particular teaching about who can be saved. In fact, this very chapter says that the elders and apostles were gathered in verses 2, 4, and 6. In verse 12, it says they were together as an assembly. That's a big meeting. And then in verse 22, it says the apostles and the elders with the whole church were all together. It was a big meeting. And you know what we call big meetings? Well, in the book of Acts chapter 15, we call it the Jerusalem Council. And throughout history, there have been meetings, big meetings, to tell us, to help us to understand what does God's word teach. And out of those big meetings come big teachings. So Paul and Barnabas talked about God's word and who can be saved. The apostles, the elders, and the whole church got together and they produced what we call a creed, a teaching. And that comes from the fancy Latin word credo, which means I believe. What do we believe? Well, we know what we believe because we know what God's word says. So this stack of books right here is all about councils and creeds and confessions of faith. And that's what we do every Sunday. The creeds of the church I want to teach you about today do some things. The one thing they don't do is they are not the same as Scripture. Creeds are not the same as Scripture. They're not inspired like God's word. They inspire us in what we should believe. They're good in terms of what they summarize. They are a good short way of knowing what the Bible teaches. And they also help us as they summarize in a very short way. That way we don't have to tell what all the Bible teaches, but they show us what the Bible teaches about Jesus and how we should live. So they summarize. Then they harmonize. Pastor Chad, that's a big word. Okay, I'll use another one. Synchronize. That's still a big word, Pastor Chad. How about standardize? Ah, Pastor Chad, you got to break it down for me. Well, how about this? All of the confessions and creeds of the church match, or they go with, our Christian brothers and sisters who throughout church history for 2,000 years, they believe the same thing we do. So that's why I say the creed summarizes, it harmonizes, synchronizes, and standardizes what we believe about Jesus and how we should live. Also, one of the things we say together on Sunday in our church is the Apostles' Creed. Do you remember that? What do we believe? I believe in God the Father, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. That's a teaching of the church called a creed, the Apostles' Creed. What also do these things do? Well, the short form of doctrine helps us memorize. Oh, Pastor Chad, come on, man. Summarize, synchronize, harmonize, standardize, and now you're telling me that I have to memorize? Yeah, because these are all shortened down so we can memorize what God's Word teaches about Jesus. Okay, enough with the big words. What also do the creeds do? Well, they categorize. Oh, here he goes again with another big word. What do we do with that? Well, they actually put into easy forms the way we think about Jesus, the way we think about sin, the way we think about church, the way we think about how we should live. It puts them in categories, little cubby holes of how we should think about what we believe. All right, enough with the big words. When we say or recite a creed on Sunday, we all recognize what we believe. And we all nod our heads and say, I believe that. I believe that. Well, guess what? Out of big meetings come big teachings, and those are called creeds. Even the Bible has creeds. In Matthew 16:16, Simon Peter says, you're the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. That's a creedal statement. That's what we believe. In John 20:28, Thomas says, my Lord and my God. Well, that's a statement of belief. And then how about in 1 Timothy 2, verse 5? For there's one God and there's one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. Guess what? Those are all summary teachings of what we believe. So when we recite Bible verses like these, or one of the creeds that come from these big meetings, we break down these big teachings about who is Jesus and what do we believe? Big meetings give us big teachings. Councils give us creeds. And I'm sorry for the big words today. Summarize, harmonize, memorize, categorize, and recognize. I guess I didn't realize. Oh, there I did it again. I'll see you next time.